Reverend Timothy J. Swenson here, Dean of Chapel, and I welcome you to this first chapel of our fall semester in the Institute's 2015-2016 school year. It is good to have you here. As we begin, let us begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our litany is from Psalm 23. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death,
I will fear no evil,
for you are with me.
Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me
in the presence of my enemies.
You anoint my head with oil.
My cup overflows.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Join me in the prayer of the day. Father in heaven, you open your hand, you satisfy the desires of every living thing. As we give you thanks for the harvest season now upon us, set in our minds the remembrance of the great harvest to be had when your Son comes in his glory. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Three scripture passages today to set the tone, set the word for the message. Hebrews 11, beginning in verse 20. By faith, Isaac invoked future blessings on Jacob and Esau. By faith, Jacob, when dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph, bowing in worship over the head of his staff. The word of the Lord. Genesis 32. The same night, Jacob arose and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream and everything else that he had. And Jacob was left alone. A man wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he touched his hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Just then from John chapter 4. And just then, Jesus' disciples came back. They marveled that he was talking with a woman, but no one said, "What did you seek? Or why are you talking with her?" So the woman left her water jar and went away into town and said to the people, "Come, see, a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ?" They went out of the town and were coming to him. The word of the Lord. Greetings to you. Greetings on this day that the Lord has made, a day for us to rejoice and be glad. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. By faith, Jacob, when dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph, bowing in worship over the head of his staff. Today is an occasion for faith. We have begun the academic year here at ILT. Students seasoned to their studies and students fresh to the task have been gathered in to their classes and books. We look at the landscape around us to see farmers in the midst of their harvest gathering as well. Today is an occasion for faith, trusting that the harvest of students is sufficient for today's work at ILT, a trusting that the harvest, the fruit of their studies, will be sufficient unto each and every student, a trusting that the farmer's harvest will be sufficient unto the needs of his family, and a trusting that the harvest will be sufficient unto the feeding of the world. Today is an occasion for faith, as all this talk of harvest brings to mind the Lord's harvest at the end of days and the Lord's harvest of each of us at the conclusion of the days of our baptism. 46 years I was a farmer, born to it, raised in it, fed by it, and lived by it. Seed time to harvest marked the passing of the seasons. Sowing and reaping named the labor of my hands. Those of you who know just how deep the dust and dirt gets into the cracks and folds of your skin, those of you who know the constant itch beneath your collar as your sweat collects the chaff from threshed grain. Yes, you. You know the truth. The truth that farming is a much romanticized vocation among those who only see it depicted and not lived. When I was but 7 or 8 years old, finally able to do those two most important things at once, depress the accelerator and see over the steering wheel of the grain truck, I was given the chore of driving the grain truck beneath the unloading auger of the combine so its hopper could be emptied and its harvesting work continued. That day was a day for faith. For my uncle, who set me in the truck, explained the workings of the pedals, showed me how to shift from neutral to first gear, and cautioned me not to run into the combine platform as I drove beneath its unloading auger. RPMs. I knew nothing of RPMs, much to the dismay of my uncle and myself, as later in the day, the constant strain of being driven quickly across the fields in low gear took its toll on the truck's engine and a rod exited the crankcase. Fall in gatherings, harvest times, days occasioning faith may be as well occasions for dismay or despair. Harvest times. These ingatherings give us pause and time to think. Time to think thoughts that usually come to us late in life. Was my life worth anything? What did I accomplish with my days? What am I harvesting? And is it sufficient? As with each of us, when we can be honest and truthful about ourselves, as with each of us, taking that perilous journey inward in self-evaluation lands us either in pride or despair. When confronted by the end of our days, neither pride nor despair is very comforting. Many of us have had the experience of sitting vigil at the bedside of the dying, the time when the days of our baptism are being harvested. For those who sit with the dying, there are occasions of restlessness and the anxiety of the inevitable and encroaching end. Overwhelm the dying, and they can't be still. A long time ago, those anxious and restless movements were named wrestling with angels. That name still applies today. You heard earlier a piece of the biblical story of Jacob. He was a working man, much accustomed to seed time and harvest, having run off at an early age to find refuge with his uncle, Jacob worked and worked, first to live, then to earn one wife, and then another. And then he worked to be free from his uncle. But by then, his brother Esau was after him, ready to call Jacob to account for his deception years before. The night before Jacob was to confront his brother, he sent his family away to their safety, and he remained alone, contemplating his life and his end. An angel, in the guise of a man, came to wrestle with him. Jacob held his own, demanded a blessing from the angel before letting go, but the angel had crippled Jacob and only then gave him a blessing. Jacob received a new name, Israel. No longer would Jacob be known as the deceiver, but now he'd be known as one who contends with God. The new name came at a price, however. Jacob would never again be self-sufficient, always crippled. He would never again be the working man he used to be. A similar, though much less violent, encounter takes place between Jesus and the Samaritan woman at Jacob's well. Jesus and the woman engage in a conversational sparring match, first about well water versus living water, and then worship versus true worship. Jesus confronts this woman with the truth about herself as a sinner and himself as God's Messiah. When the woman runs off to town, she just can't stay silent, shouting, "Come and see the man who told me all that I had ever done. Come and see the one who told me the truth about myself." We don't have to be in the harvest of our final days or to be wrestling with angels to be confronted with the truth about ourselves. Many of you have gone time and again to a sanctuary on Sunday morning. Together, you who worship, you'd engage the order of confession and forgiveness. In that order, you hear again and again these words: "If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us." When it comes to the worth of our days, when it comes to the meaning of our life, the truth is indeed not in us. Our capacity for self-deception is boundless. Turning to ourselves in self-examination, asking ourselves, "Am I good enough? Am I worthy enough? Have I done enough? Am I faithful enough?" The inevitable end of that inward journey is either pride or despair. Either one is just the emotional manifestation of self-deception and an open announcement that the truth is not in us. No wonder, then, that neither pride nor despair is very comforting when we are confronted by the end of our days and the Lord's harvest to come. Like the psalmist walking through the valley of the shadow of death, you do not find comfort looking within. There you only find those twin deceptions of pride and despair. But you do receive comfort from outside of yourselves. You receive comfort from the Word of God, from God's rod and staff, from the chastising and rebuking rod of God's law, and from the gathering and securing staff of God's gospel. In other words, when Jesus, the Word of God, confronts you with the truth about yourselves, your self-deception will come to an end. There. Just there, in Jesus Christ, there you receive comfort and hope. Though you are sinners, dead in your sin, Jesus Christ died for you so that you might have eternal life. Like the psalmist, you will then find walking through the valley of the shadow of death a little thing when and if God's rod and staff has already done its work upon you. When you have the truth, that is, when you have Jesus Christ, then you know that you are a sinner condemned by God's law. But even though condemned, you have been given new life through the gospel of Jesus Christ. When you have this truth, that you're dead in sin and Christ is your life, when you have such truth, walking through the valley of the shadow of death is a little thing. You are one of those baptized by water and the Word into the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And you have heard these words, child of God. You have been marked by the cross of Christ and sealed by the Holy Spirit forever. Condemned by God's law, promised life by the gospel of Christ, you live out the days of your baptism, as all do who are subjected to God's rod and God's staff. When the harvest of days comes, when the days of your baptism are concluded, when you have traversed the valley of the shadow of death, when all questions of worth, value, and sufficiency are finally silenced, when you will never again be that working man or woman who you once were, then you will wait, as you have through these days of your baptism, wait, as will all of us, to be called out by that name given to you and to each of us by water and God's Word, child of God. When our Lord Jesus comes, on that day when He appears in glory, all the dead shall rise. Jesus will call forth all those who know the truth about themselves and God. To those who are then gathered around Him, He will say with delight, child of God, you are mine. I have claimed you. The harvest is done. Thanks be to God. Amen. You'll be invited to respond at the end of each prayer petition with, Lord, in your mercy, and your response will be, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Father in heaven, grant to us confidence and faith that the harvest will be sufficient, and confidence that the days of our baptism will yield eternal life with you and your Son. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father in heaven, hold us as preachers and teachers of the faith to this and succeeding generations. Hold us firm on the foundation of Christ and His cross. Lord, in your mercy. Father in heaven, grant the fellowship of Christ and His cross to us in the entirety of the ILT community, so that none seek their own glory, but only what glory is had in the cross of Christ. Lord, in your mercy. Father in heaven, grant God's power and protection would surround students who suffer persecution and hardship as they take up their crosses daily and follow Jesus. Lord, in your mercy. Father in heaven, grant the light of Christ shine in the darkness as the proclamation of your word goes forth. Grant that more and more students will be drawn to Christ in the study of His word to make manifold confession that Jesus alone is Lord. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.